All righty, good morning, church.
Good morning.
How are you guys doing tonight or this morning? We're doing good. All right, let's get straight into our Bibles here. Let's go to John chapter 5. You know what? Everyone loves a good victory.
Yeah.
You know, everyone loves to win. Let's be honest about that.
Yeah.
I mean, the first time when I was playing soccer, I'll be honest, I was bad, right? No. I played for like 3 years. On the last year of my soccer career, I'm going for the goal.
Ooh.
I was a little kid back then, probably like around 10, 9, 8. I was pretty fast in my time, but my legs weren't good. I couldn't really control my legs when I'm running or with the ball. But I remember the first time I had a line break with the ball. It was just me halfway and the goalkeeper. There was no one in front of me, and I was going for glory. 3 years of my life, I have been waiting to just score one goal. I remember the first time I kicked that ball in, the goalkeeper goes to get the ball, he misses the ball, and the ball is slowly rolling its way in the goals. That was probably the most important day of my soccer career.
Then you retired.
That was, yeah, then I retired. You know, we all love a perfect victory. You know, who plays a game to wish to lose? No one does that, right? We're going to see how the Bible describes victories. And the title of my lesson this morning is The Miracle of Victory. All right, I got 2 points for you guys. That's together in complete unity.
Wow.
And point number two is faithful till God's victory. Let's go to Joshua chapter 5.
Come on, buddy.
So we have a story here of Joshua. So at the time, Israel had been deserted in the desert for 40 years. It was a dry moment in their career, and at that time, they were hoping for a victory to give them some more hope. You know, God had allowed the old generation, the faithless generation, to die off and for a new generation to come. So we pick up here in verses 2. The Bible reads, "At that time, the Lord said to Joshua, 'Make flint knives and circumcise the Israelites again.' So Joshua made flint knives and circumcised the Israelites at Gibeah Haraloth. Now this is why he did so. All those that came out of Egypt, all the men of military age, died in the wilderness on the way after leaving Egypt. All the people that came out had been circumcised, but all the people born in the wilderness during the journey from Egypt had not. The Israelites had moved about in the wilderness 40 years until all the men who were of military age when they left Egypt had died, since they had not obeyed the Lord. For the Lord had sworn to them that they would not see the land he had solemnly promised their ancestors to give us, a land flowing with milk and honey. So he raised up their sons in their place, and these were the ones Joshua circumcised. They were still uncircumcised because they had not been circumcised on the way. And after the whole nation had been circumcised, they remained where they were in the camp until they were healed. Then the Lord said to Joshua, 'Today I have rolled away the reproach of Egypt from you, so the place has been called Gilgal to this day.'" You know, God commands complete unity before the victory.
Yeah.
You know, partial unity and complete unity are very different things.
Yeah.
And I'll show you guys the difference here. You know, partial unity had proven to be ineffective in Israel's past and history. You know, the reason why the Israelites were caught in the desert, it's because they had simply disobeyed God. Now, God said, "The promised land is waiting for you." They went out with the spies and they came back with a faithless report, which was against what God had promised. You know, partial unity gets you nowhere.
Yeah.
No, you can be the best player in your team. You could have the best players in your team, but still lose the game.
Yeah.
You know, for some of you Maroon fans, I'm sure you guys experienced that last week. The New South Wales Blues, they won the victory, amen?
Yeah.
You know, but in the same way, we can have, you know, everyone coming to church here, but not everyone not participating in the church. You know, Tyrone could be here happily singing, "I've been redeemed," having a great time, but some could be on their phones. Some could be watching on their watches. When's the service going to finish? Right, excited to get out rather than to sing praise to God.
Come on.
Or even in our own households, our family households. You know, we maybe been in different households with different people, and it's like, you know, your parents, they call you, "Hey guys, come on kids, let's have dinner." They gather you all together, and we have our sister on her phone, our brother not even talking, Now, there's like some partial unity over here.
Yeah.
You know, we know that teamwork makes the dream work.
Yes.
You know, partial unity is a disunity.
Yeah.
You know, complete unity is the only way that will lead to a victory.
Yeah.
You know, God, the first thing he did was he got all the males to get circumcised.
Mm.
If you guys know what circumcision is, it's when the foreskin is removed by a sharp tool and it causes a lot of pain. It was a powerful act of consecration to God and unity among God's people.
Mm.
Israel alone was represented, the representatives of God, and that's how they identified themselves, when they had got circumcised.
Mm.
You know, complete unity can cause pain, can cause sacrifice.
Yeah.
It's something that can actually, it requires us to deny ourselves in order to enforce unity amongst us.
Yeah.
You know, I remember a time when I was in living in a brother's household, and it's just with the, you know, other men in the church. We lived together, and the household wasn't going very well. There was a lot of arguments, like people didn't like each other, everyone was separate in their own little rooms. And there was a time where we had to really address this disunity. So we got together as one family. It was like probably 9, 10 p.m. at night, and we talked about all these issues. We said, hey, I didn't like this, I didn't like that. We have to forgive each other. It was a very unifying moment.
Mm.
And one brother steps up and goes the extra mile. He goes, all right, guys, to seal what we just conversated about, let's all jump into the pool outside.
Mm.
And I'm like, man, it's 12 a.m. I go work tomorrow. It's winter. It was cold. I'm like, I don't want to do this. In my heart, there was some wrestling. But we all decided to deny ourselves, to walk downstairs, to jump in the pool together, and it was a very incredible bonding moment we had together. And after that, we're just wrestling to get into the shower, you know? But, you know, our best friends are often the ones you fight with.
Yeah.
You know, one of my other best friends, his name is Ned, and, you know, at the time, I used to live with him, and he used to be pretty annoying. Like, literally, I'll be rooming with him, I'll be having my night sleep, and he'll be poking me, wake up, wake up. I'm like, you just, you know, have you ever had those brothers or sisters who just, you know, irritate you a bit?
Yeah.
We didn't get really long, but then we addressed the issues, and now we're like very close friends. We call each other like very so often. So, you know, even powerful armies in the world, they're forged by sacrifice and pain.
Yeah.
If you guys know about the Israeli special forces, they're one of the most highest military camps in the whole world. The most powerful, most expert, they're like perfect in almost how they work together as a team.
Mm.
And so one of the interviewers actually interviewed some of these troops, and they asked him, you know, one of these troops were known as a heroic figure. So troops that had been sacrificed their life for a particular person or situation in that time. And they asked him, you know, why did you do what you did? And the guy would simply respond, I did it because they would do the same for me.
Mm.
You know, would you do the same for your brothers and sisters? You know, how embarrassed would God feel if a military camp was more unified than his church?
Wow.
Now, what sacrifice will it take for you to get completely unified with your brothers and sisters? You know, would that be moving into a brother's household or a sister's household? Now, I know for my experience, this has been the most unifying thing in my life as a Christian.
Mm.
The most enjoyable time as a Christian, where our foundations start in the household.
Yep. Yeah.
Now, how about just sacrificing time?
Mm.
Just our own time, maybe playing game, instead of, you know, playing game or going on social media, we're spending time with our brothers and sisters, quality time.
Yeah.
Now, I'm gonna lift up Raph, who actually, we had a good conversation last week, and he was actually expressing that, you know, he's considering dropping his love for soccer, which we know is up there.
Yeah.
So that he can spend more time in the ministry.
Come on,
now, Raph is someone who sees his need to spend more time with the brothers and sisters.
Wow.
Or maybe if you're financially well off, maybe it's a sacrifice of your money, where you could be spending more money on yourself. You could be spending it buying your brothers and sisters gifts, giving them encouragement cards, or taking them on kingdom dates. You know, God is all about being one.
Come on.
I want you guys to turn to John chapter 17.
Let's go, brother.
The Bible reads, my prayer is not for them alone. I pray also for those who believe in me through their message, that all of them may be one, Father, just as you are in me and I am in you. May they also be in us, so that the world may believe that you have sent me. I've given them the glory that you gave me, that they may be one as we are one. I in them and you in me, so that they may be brought to complete unity. Then the world will know that you sent me and have loved me even as you have loved me. Now the number one in the Bible, it means to be unified and complete.
Yeah.
No, the word one here is actually used 7 times, which means to be complete.
Wow.
The Bible says we are of one body. In Ephesians chapter 4, verses 4-6, it says there is one body and one spirit, just as you were called to one hope, as you were called, one Lord, one baptism, one faith, one God and Father of all, who is over all and through all and in all. You know, God wants us to be one and complete. One complete church.
Yeah.
This is very contrary to what we see in our day today. If you look around in different churches, we are not unified. We look around in different groups or denominations in Christianity. You look, ask them what they really believe in, you get very different answers.
Yep.
Yeah. Now, different forms of salvation. Some believe if I just pray a prayer, God forgive me, I'll be saved. Some believe if I just have faith alone, that will save me, which is just not in the Bible. Some have a standards of different discipleship. What does it mean to live as a Christian? Some say, you know, discipling is optional. I don't need to be corrected, rebuked, trained by other Christians. I have God alone. Some optional to share your faith, evangelize. It's not a necessary thing. Even the forgiveness towards your brothers and sisters is not being addressed in churches today.
True.
You know, different churches, they try to create a sense of complete unity by grabbing all these different churches. We see that on campus even. We try to get these unified groups which get denominations from all different from places around their environment, or local environment, and they're just not unified on the same beliefs and principles.
Yeah.
You know, it's a false sense of unity that we see in churches today.
Yeah.
We cannot all be true. And it's sad that I meet people on a regular basis who claim to be Christians, but they don't even want to study the Bible. I ask them, hey, let's study the Bible. Let's get unified on the scriptures. And they're not even happy to be unified on the scriptures. Now, this is the condition of our world today.
Yeah.
My challenge for you guys is if you are visiting today, I'm going to encourage you to study the Bible with us.
Come on.
To get unified on the Word of God.
Yeah.
And to find your convictions directly from the Bible, to get unified according to that.
Yeah.
You know, the awesome thing about the scriptures is that God actually blesses unity.
Yeah.
You know, there's so much rewards that we can get from being completely unified.
Yeah.
You know, we see here in verse 9 that the Bible says that God, He rolls away the reproach that He had with Israel.
Mm-hmm.
At the moment they were completely unified, He rolled all the reproach,
yeah,
all the past or the negative views that He had on Israel.
Mm.
You know, I think about the miracles that we've had as a movement being completely unified.
Yeah.
If you guys don't know, we had a lead evangelist or a leader in our churches in India, and he had COVID-19.
Mm.
And in India, if you guys have heard the news, it's crazy.
Yeah.
There's not enough hospitals to cater for all the cases that they're getting in India, and people are left on the waiting list to get healed for coronavirus. And we had our leader evangelist who had coronavirus, and the movement decided to all fast together for him to be healed. And without a surprise, he was healed.
Yeah.
You see, God does bless complete unity.
Yeah.
I remember a time also one of our evangelists, his name is Luke Speckman. So he had a dream to be more personally fruitful for the Bible talk. And he made the whole Bible talk fast until they're personally fruitful. You know, they all fasted. They're looking for the one particular individual who was going to become fruitful. And then she stopped studying the Bible. And it discouraged everyone. They're like, are we still going to fast? Is this going to still, are we going to do this still?
Wow.
But Luke held on to his faith. He said, let's still get unified. We made a vow to God. Let's go after it. They kept fasting, and they were personally fruitful.
Yeah.
Come on.
You know, Publius Sychar is an ancient writer. He says, where there is unity, there is always a victory.
Wow.
Now, I want to challenge you guys with the Jericho Challenge.
Ooh.
We see here that they marched around 7 times, in unity. Mm-hmm. On the seventh day, they marked seven times. Mm-hmm. I want to challenge you guys, the days you guys go evangelizing, usually the Monday, Tuesday, and Thursdays, I want you guys to pray around your campus.
Woo, come on.
And on the seventh day, which is on the third Monday, go around seven times. And pray for the walls of your campus to drop.
Come on.
Let's go to point number two.
Awesome.
Faithful to God's victory.
Here we go.
In Joshua chapter 6, the Bible reads, "Now the gates of Jericho were securely barred because of the Israelites. No one went out and no one came in. Then the Lord said to Joshua, 'See, I have delivered Jericho into your hands, along with its kings and its fighting men. March around the city once with all the armed men. Do this for 6 days. Have seven priests carry trumpets of ram horns in front of the ark. On the seventh day, march around the city seven times, with the priests blowing the trumpets. When you hear them sound the long blast on the trumpets, have the whole army give a loud shout. Then the wall of the city will collapse, and the army will go up, everyone straight in.'" Verse 8, "When Joshua had spoken to the people, the seven priests carrying the seven trumpets before the Lord went forward, blowing their trumpets. And the ark of the Lord's covenant followed them. The armed guard marched ahead of the priests and who blew the trumpets, and the rear guard followed the ark. All this time the trumpets were sounding, but Joshua had commanded the army, 'Do not give a war cry. Do not raise your voices. Do not say a word until the day I tell you to shout. Then shout!' So he and the ark of the Lord carried around the city, circling it once. Then the army returned to camp and spent the night there." In verse 15, "On the seventh day, they got up at daybreak and marched around the city seven times in the same manner, except that on that day, they circled the city seven times. The seventh time around, when the priest sounded the trumpet blast, Joshua commanded the army, 'Shout! For the Lord has given you this city. The city and all that is in it are to be devoted to the Lord.'" In verse 20, "When the trumpet sounded, the army shouted, and at the sound of the trumpet, when the men gave a loud shout, the wall collapsed. So everyone charged in, and they took the city."
Wow.
You know, it was never a question if God would give them a victory.
Yeah. Mm.
It was always, would they take the victory?
Yeah.
Wow.
God was waiting for them to respond with faith and obedience.
Yeah.
You know, we see here the context of Jericho. It was known as a powerful city.
Yeah.
You think about like the Navy SEALs, even like the Israeli forces, they were like the top notch in the Canaan area.
Wow.
If you look here in the diagram, the outer wall was around 4 to 5 meters high. On top of that was a mud brick wall around 6 to 8 meters higher.
Crazy.
And 2 meters thick. Our walls are not even like a meter thick.
Yeah.
But here, it's well fortified.
Mm.
The inner wall was contained a similar mud brick measured at 14 meters above the ground level. To Jericho, they had it well built.
Yeah.
They had the advantage. They could see the Israelites at a distance. They can throw whatever they want at them. They had the advantage. It says even in verse 6, the gates were securely barred. Mm-hmm. No one could come in or out. They had every defense. Just imagine being an Israelite at that time. How would have you felt? You come to the promised land and you see this city. And you're like, how are we going to get through this city? But you see, God asks us a question here. Do you see? The first thing comes out of his mouth to Joshua is, see.
Yeah.
In Hebrews chapter 11, verse 1, it says, "Now faith is confidence in what we do not hope for and assurance of what we do not see."
Yeah.
You know, some argue that faith is blind.
Mm.
It's true.
Yeah.
But faith is not ignorant.
Wow. Come on.
What does God see behind our faith? In Luke chapter 18, verse 27, it says, "Jesus replied, 'What is impossible with man is possible with God.'"
Yeah.
Do you see the impossibilities or the possibilities?
Come on, Brandon.
Do you see obstacles in your life or do you view them as opportunities?
Yeah.
You know, God knows all the possibilities. I think about if you're like Dr. Strange, you know, you just calculate every single possibility. You know, God knows each and every possibility.
Wow. Yeah.
He knows from the start to the end. He is the Alpha and the Omega.
Amen. Mm.
He is absolutely confident about your future. He sees the victory ahead of time. You know, God will is the attribute we must have when it comes to seeing our victories come true.
Yeah.
God will grow the church.
Yeah.
Why? Because he says it.
Yeah.
And the Lord added to the number daily those who are being saved. Acts chapter 2, verse 47.
Yeah. Right. Yeah.
God will create unity in brothers and sisters' households. Mm-hmm. In Ephesians chapter 2, it says, consequently, you are no longer foreigners or strangers, but fellow citizens on God's people and also members of his household.
Yeah.
Built on the foundation of the apostles' teachings and the prophets, with Christ Jesus himself as the chief cornerstone.
Mm-hmm.
Our family will study the Bibles and become Christians. In 1 Timothy chapter 2, it reads, I urge then first of all that petitions, prayers, intercessions, and thanksgiving be made for all people, for kings and all those in authority, that we may live peaceful and quiet lives in all godliness and holiness. This is good and pleases God our Savior, who wants all people to be saved.
Yeah.
We have to have this attitude that if God says it, that settles it.
Wow, come on.
Do you see the victories this year before they're happening? Some of us, we want to be dating.
Ooh.
Do you see that? Some of us want to be personally fruitful. Do you see that? Some of us want to see our ministries grow by double. Do you see that?
Come on.
Do you see the victories before it's happening?
Wow.
You know, Israel was obedient to the vision. It's as simple as the Shema. The Hebrew word Shema means listen and obey. All they did is simply you listen to God and they obeyed the Lord God.
Yeah.
Come on.
You know, God had already given them the promise and all they had to do was simply obey.
Yeah.
You know, sometimes we believe God is a bit unkind, that he sometimes restrains his promises from us.
Mm-hmm.
He wants us to suffer more, to go through a bit more hardship before we take that.
Yeah.
But the truth is, it's not that way. God is just waiting for you to take that with faith. You know, in Jeremiah chapter 29, verse 11 to 13, the Bible reads, for I know the plans I have for each and every one of you.
Come on.
The plan to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you hope and a future.
Yeah.
It says, then you'll call and come and pray to me and I'll listen to you. You'll seek me and find me when you seek me with all of your heart.
Yeah.
You know, the Bible says clearly, right? God has a plan for your life. It's a great plan, not to prosper you, not to harm you, to give you hope and a future.
Mm.
You know, once again, we need to just Shema. We need to believe in this.
Yes.
We need to listen to this and we need to obey this promise.
Yeah. Come on.
You know, it's as simple as that. God's already given you the victory. All you have to do is Shema.
Hey, man. Come on.
I want to give you some examples of people who have obeyed the calling and vision of God. I lift up our lead evangelist and women ministry leader,
woo!
Tegan and Sean Valenzuela. If you guys don't know, so the church started here 2 years ago. And how long did they know before they had to come here?
Oh.
Well, a few days?
Yeah.
In a few days, they had a call given by our evangelist in Sydney to come and lead the church here.
Mm-hmm.
Within a few days, they decided to pack up all their belongings. Whatever possessions they had, family they had, they left it all behind to start the church that we have here today.
Mm.
They deserve another round of applause. Man. I think about even our lead evangelists in cities, Joe and Carrie.
Come on.
So we had an even time with Ian and Margo, which was really incredible. That they had sacrificed so much just to build the church in Sydney, which helped build the church here.
Yeah.
But they traveled all the way to America and LA to get training when the church was breaking apart. To come back and to restart a godly church.
Yeah.
Even our main evangelist or our central leader, Kip McKean,
mm-hmm.
the best decision he's ever made is restarting the movement when it broke apart.
Yeah.
That's what I mean, the hardest things that anyone could have done. Because
he
held onto his original convictions.
Sure.
You know, another special person in the room here today has obeyed the calling of God.
Yeah.
And her name is Emma.
Yeah.
Emma has been coming around. She has been studying the Bible and say she makes a decision to make Jesus Lord of her life.
Come on,
to obey the vision that God had for her life, that she's going to make not just an impact among us, but in her families,
yeah.
in her friends,
cool.
in her community, and around the world.
Amen.
My challenge for you guys is, what is God calling you at this time to do? And it's just waiting for you to make that decision of faith.
Mm-hmm.
You know, what is God calling you to do?
Mm-hmm.
I'll leave you guys with these 2 points. Together in complete unity and faithful to God's victory.
Mm-hmm.
And I have a little poem for you guys.
Ooh, nice.
What is it you dream of?
Mm-hmm.
How far will you go?
Mm-hmm.
To show the world your greatness so everyone will know.
Mm-hmm.
Will you go the distance? Will you pay the price? Learning all the lessons and heeding good advice. There are no guarantees, no tricks, and no sure thing. There's simply faith and love that define what hope may bring.
Wow.
It's when it comes together, the perfect turn of fate, when the strength pushes forward to enter victory's gate.
Yes.
To God be all the glory.
You gotta preach, preach, preach the word. 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 You see, I was lost before I was found in my pride.